So, let us start with our last session today. Topic today, network and security improvements with DPUs, data processing units. My name is Jörg Rösch, lead solution engineer for network and security at VMware, responsible for the German public market. Usual disclaimer, so please take it into account. So, short my agenda. First, I want to talk about the industrial challenges. Then I want to talk about an overview over our solution with DPUs. Then I want to jump in the architecture, in the inner workings, how the DPU designed from the hardware perspective, and then also to the data path model behind. Afterwards, I will talk about some use cases, then about the installation part, and then I will jump to the current features which are supported currently with our distributed service engine. That's the name for the DPU support with vSphere 8 and NSX 4. Afterwards, hopefully we have some time for Q&A. Okay, what are the challenges today? I think, you know, we talked a lot of on this conference as well. We have all this cloud native, Kubernetes, container stuff, which requires a lot of I/O traffic, volume, complexity, and so on. And on the other hand, we have that our security threats are evolving. This means it's not enough to have a dedicated north-south firewall in front of your data center, and you don't care about your applications inside or about your flows, because you have no clue about your application topology and also about the behaviors. On the other hand, we have not only VMs, we have containers, as I've already mentioned. We have DPUs, CPU requirements, GPUs, especially when we are talking here about the AI world, I would say. And this all ends a little bit in operational silos and complexity. So, how we can solve this? At the end of the day, we need a higher compute density and an accelerated security as well. So we need really a performant layer 7 security, and we need also to take care about security between containers, still to VMs, still to bare metal servers, and we need one management plane to establish this. Now I come to an overview. So here our usual x86 E6i host. What do you have currently before DPU? We have here all NSX services, switching, routing, firewalling, monitoring, are running on the x86 itself. What we're doing right now with our DPU solution, we are putting these services to an intelligence network card. We're currently supporting the NVIDIA and AMD Pensando. And there's a slide, you see here, DPU and SmartNIC. There's a slight difference between a SmartNIC and a DPU. A SmartNIC is designed for network performance. A DPU and a SmartNIC has only or is using the existing OS system. A DPU, which we are using, is a little bit different. It's broader. It's not only taking care about the network improvements, it's also taking care about security and storage as well. And what is also a difference, we have here really on the DPU a dedicated lightweight E6i image running, which is really designed for performance. Yeah, what are the advantages about this? We have a physical isolation between our workload and infrastructure domain, and this is especially in my customer area. I'm working here a lot of for armed forces, military customers, very important, because with this, they can fulfill their regulation requirements. Okay, what are the other advantages? Yeah, okay, network performance, latency-wise, throughput-wise, and same for security. And the other thing is the visibility. When we are talking about security, you need some intelligence behind. You need to take care about every flow in your data center to have a whole picture. And what we can do with the DPU, we can directly analyze the flows. So you don't need any port mirroring or tabs, which are really complicated. With our E6e host, you can directly get the flows to your systems. For example, we have here a network detection response solutions, where we really analyze day zero attacks and much more. And this is quite easy. Other point is, interesting point is, we free up the computer resources from the hypervisor, from the x86. And with this, it's really a topic for sustainability, because we need less power consumptions, and we need also less server mounts. Okay, I know, this is really a little bit difficult to have some calculations, because it depends a little bit on your infrastructure, on your application landscape, and so on. But there's also a good white paper from NVIDIA who's talking about the sustainability topic. Okay, roadmap. Currently, what we are supporting is NSX services, offloading and accelerated to the DPU. Roadmap topic is we want to have also storage, vSAN, on the DPU running, and in the future, bare metal as well. Okay, now I come to the inner workings. How's it running? Here you see a picture from a DPU card. On the left side, you have a management port. You have two production Ethernet ports. And the hard piece of this device is really the programmable accelerator. You can see here. CPU is ARM-based, ARM processor. And on the flash, there's really this E6E lightweight image configured. Below, you see some information about fast pass, low pass. I come later on a little bit more in detail to this when I'm talking about the DPU, fast pass and slow pass and so on. How is it connected? So you see here our E6i motherboard. Here you have a connection from your DPU from the PCI level. And you have as well a connector on the card sitting here, which goes then over a daughter card to your BMC, to your base management controller for lifecycle management. Okay, now I want to talk about the data path model. How is it running? But before I want to talk about the DPU data path model, I want to show you how is it currently running with a usual VDS switch. So you see here below, what's going on? Ah, now. Okay. Excuse me. Okay. You see here, standard DWS switch, how the data path model be realized. Packet comes on the physical NIC driver, and every packet, for every packet, you have a CPU interrupt and a context switch to the slow path. In regarding your routing, switching, firewall configuration, the packet will be forwarded or dropped. When the packet will be forwarded to your VM, to your VNIC, you have again an interrupt from your CPU and your and a context switch. And you know, especially with applications which have a high packet rate, you have a really high CPU load and you're getting in trouble. This is a normal VDS data path model. Before DPU, we had also two different data path models. Where we can have a performant data path model, I would say. One of them, I think the old vSphere guys all know this, as a IOV, single root input output virtualization. How is this running? Packet comes again on the NIC. We have always a handover between the physical function and the virtual function, and the packet will be directly forwarded. There will be a complete bypass from the x86 from your vSwitch, and your packet will be forwarded. So you have here really less CPU consumption. But the big disadvantage from this solution is you have a dependency from your VNIC pull mode driver to your NIC driver. And due to this, you cannot use any HA features, vMotion, DIS, HA, and so on. And I would say, this is not really virtualization stuff when you have this kind of vMotion. When I can remember the time when VMware has announced vMotion, this was really a game changer. And we have your kind of solution without vMotion. It makes not much sense from my point of view. Then we have also another possibility. It's named Enhanced Data Path Model. This is coming with NSX. What we can do there, packet arrives here again on the physical NIC. We have a really dedicated CPU cores in polling mode for this solution. And every time when a packet arrives, the packet will be copied to a shared memory location and the CPU constantly polling the shared memory location in a round-robin fashion. Then, when the packet or when the packet information, the control plane information is available in the fast pass, in the flow cache, the packet will be forwarded. When it comes the first time, there will be a mismatch. It goes again to a slow pass, and regarding your NSX manager configuration, the packet will be forwarded, routing, switching, firewalling-wise. Then the packet will be forwarded, and the next time when the packet will be sent, the slow pass has been updated to the fast pass, and your information will be available in the flow cache. Here again, when we compare these two solutions, on one side, as a IOE pass-through, vSwitch, as I've mentioned, completely bypassed, no additional CPU load, very good from a performance point of view, but you have the disadvantages from the hardware dependencies and from the the HA features are not available. On the other hand, enhanced data pass. One point is also, it's a little bit more difficult to install. You have here the NSX configuration. It's not quite easy to implement the EDP pass, but it's not bad. It's better from, you have some CPU load, to be honest, sure. But when you compare to your normal VDS mode, it's much better. Yeah, and all these HA features are available and so on. What we have done right now with DPU, we combined these two modes to a real performance mode, and we have also then the DPU acceleration in hardware. How is it running? Here you see below the DPU card. Packet arrives, then we have a hardware table. Decision will be made in hardware. That's the most important point as a takeaway. And when, again, when the information is here in the hardware table, packet will be directly forwarded. If the information is not available, we have again the EDP pass. So, packet will be copied in a shared memory location. CPU is constantly polling the shared memory location around robin fashion again. And when the information is there in the flow cache, packet will be forwarded. If not, it goes again to the slow pass. Regarding your NSX manager configuration, routing, switching, firewalling-wise, packet will be forwarded or dropped. Next time, no wonder, I would say, slow pass has been updated, the fast pass, and the fast pass has been updated, the hardware table, decision is then in hardware available, and the control plane function is sitting here, and when your packet arrives, decision will be made in hardware. This is the emulated mode, which I have described right now. This is a default mode. So it's a little bit complicated. We are always good at VMware with renaming different things. Probably you will see this also as max mode, because at the beginning when we have announced it, or all this DPU stuff comes from a project Monterey, and initially we have named it max mode, but we have renamed it a few weeks ago. It's emulated mode right now. Same, unfortunately, is here for VM Direct Pass. We name it now VM Direct Pass. But usually you often see here UPT V2 mode, Uniform Pass-Through mode. And you see also in the GUI UPT, because this mode is also an option for high-performance VMs. You can activate it, and then it's a formally SIOV mode with a completely bypass from the vSwitch, from the x86. And how you can activate it? You can go just to your vCenter, you can go to your VM, you do a check mark for UPT V2, and then the mode is activated. And you can use this feature right now with all HA features available. That's the biggest advantage from this solution. So you have these two possibilities. You have the default mode, where you have already hardware acceleration, and for really high performance workloads, you can activate it on your VM here, the VM Direct Pass mode or UPT V2 mode. Here again, I compare these two different modes which are available with a DPU. On the right side, VM Direct Pass or Uniform Pass-Through mode, near zero CPU consumption, complete guest memory reservation, requires an VMX Net3 version 7 driver, very important, high performance, low latency data pass model, And what is also important point is here, UBT, VMs, there's a limitation. When you have virtual functions, you have always a limitations per NIC card. You can have 256, 512, whatever, you have to check this. There you must be a little bit be careful. But usually you don't activate the UBT V2 mode or VM Direct mode for all VMs in your environment. So usually you don't have any issues with this. And on the other hand, we have the emulated default mode. As I've mentioned, less CPU consumptions when you compare it to a usual DVR switch. No guest memory reservation, no driver dependencies at all. Performance accelerated in hardware again. And we have with this a higher workload density. Now I come a little bit to use cases. Yeah, okay. Use case, distributed firewall, distributed IDS, IPS. I think all of you already heard about micro-segmentation. So I will go there really quickly through this point. What we are doing here, let me check. Sure, with distributed firewall in common, we have a single management plane. We have no dependency to any VLAN structure, overlay structure, whatever. What we can do here very easy, when we want to secure communication between VMA and VMB, which are on the same network, it's no problem for us because our policy is sitting in front of the VNIC. And we also support the container with distributed firewalling. Sure, it's a little bit different. You have to work with tags and so on, with objects, because you have no real VNIC. But what we can do with the solution here with TPU, we completely can offload and accelerate the distributed firewall function here to the DPU. For IDS IPS, it's currently in a tech preview, to be honest. So it's not fully supported right now. It's not on our roadmap. But distributed firewall is already fully supported. And we have done there also some really significant tests with one termed Armed Force customers. We have their white paper, which is already published 2 days ago. So you can have a look. It's very interesting because you see there in this document that we can put much more firewall rules on the VNIC level, and you have a much better performance, especially when we are talking about distributed firewall and our security solutions. Yeah. What is also important? I don't know. Yeah. It's not a V2T migration, I would say. You just go to the vCenter admin, just uses the vCenter, just creates the VDS switch, just can add the uplinks and so on. There's no change at all from the management plane perspective. It's more the hardware change behind. There's a lot of intelligence in a DPU card, that's for sure. But it's only a hardware change. Everything would be done from the vSphere administrator, still on the vCenter level. And for the NSX manager administrator, it's the same. You still go to the NSX manager, do your routing, switching stuff, and so on. Currently supported, what you must is also important, which server vendors are currently supported. We have Dell, we have here HPE, and Lenovo. We have other vendors on the roadmap as well. But this is the current stage. And from the DPU perspective, we have currently NVIDIA supported, AMD, and Intel's roadmap. So these are the three vendors where we are currently working about. Now I come to the installation part, how we install this kind of solution. So the first thing is you roll out your usual ESXi image, and your DPU card will be automatically detected. You do a check mark on your DPU card, and then the ESXi image will be rolled out to the x86 and to the DPU in parallel as well. Second step is that you create a VDS switch. There you also choose NVIDIA or AMD Pensando card. And the third step would be that you do the ESXi or the NSX VIP rollout with a life cycle manager. And the last point is that you have the option for high performance requirements to activate the UBT V2 mode. And that's all. So, what is currently supported? So we support currently overlay, VLAN-based segments, routing, switching, as I've already mentioned. As I have also mentioned here, distributed firewalling is supported, and IDS-IPS is a tech preview. Here, okay, some normal stuff, visibility, operations, traceflow, IPFix, and so on. And here, again, the BlueField 2 card from NVIDIA with 25 gigabit and 100 gigabit, and also with 25 gigabit and 100 gigabit for AMD Pensando. Then, scaling-wise, we currently only support one DPU. That's also, but it's on a near roadmap, I would say. What is also interested, we have announced, I think it was yesterday or two days ago, VCF 5.1. And with VCF 5.1, we also support their DPU as well. Key takeaways, NSX is offloaded to the smart card. Yeah, the hardware acceleration, no change at all from the UI perspective, from the administrator point of view. Same UI, better security performance, and also sustainability. That's the most important points which I wanted to address today. And you see some resources, as I've already mentioned. We have a white paper with BWI. We have also on YouTube from our technical product managers a lot of interesting videos about this. There's a playlist around this. You can search for this very easy. You can find it. And there's also an interesting documentation from NVIDIA about the sustainability. It's not based on our solution, but it's usually not mandatory. It's common, described there, DPU, what you can reach, how you can reach there, and power efficiency. Okay. Also interesting, okay, everything is recorded. We have the last session today, but maybe you can have a look afterwards when you're at home. There's some really interesting sessions from NVIDIA, from AMD, from our side. You can have a look at this after the conference. Okay, with this, I say thank you, and I wish you really a nice trip home and have a nice time.